Good morning. My name is Bus Garnett. I'm an Arlington attorney. I've been a member of the Arlington County Bar Association since 1966. I was president of the association in 1977 and 1978. The Arlington legal community has an extraordinary history, as does the County of Arlington. The Arlington County Bar Foundation, which is the charitable arm of the Arlington County Bar Association, wanted to preserve the rich history by producing a series of conversations with judges and lawyers who were part of that history to record their reflections, memories, and stories for future generations of students, lawyers, judges, and the public. Last month, we were fortunate enough to have with us four circuit court judges who collectively served the County of Arlington for over 100 years. Today, we have with us three distinguished senior Arlington attorneys whose combined legal careers span over a period of 160 years. It is with pleasure now that I introduce the following. To my immediate right is Paul Varoutous, a longtime Arlington practitioner. Paul is the baby of this group at age 84. To my far left is Grady Malone, likewise a longtime Arlington resident and Arlington attorney. Grady is 90 years of age, and I have the personal privilege of introducing next to me my father, Griff Garnett, who at age 91 is probably the dean of the Arlington County Bar Association. Gentlemen, I thank you for joining us. I would like to ask each of you a few generic questions as to your personal backgrounds and how you wound up in Arlington. Dad, let me talk to you first. You graduated from college when and where?
I graduated from the University of Richmond in 1936.
And where did you go to law school?
I came to Washington, got a job in the government, started National University Law School in 1936, and graduated in 39, and took the bar, State Virginia, in 1940, and became a member of the bar during that year.
When did you come to Arlington County?
1940.
What drew you to Arlington County?
Well, I had passed the Virginia bar. I had been an assistant clerk of the United States District Court for the District of Columbia, and I knew there were opportunities for a young lawyer in Arlington with some of the smaller cases that the D.C. bar members wanted to send over, so I came over here and started practice.
When you first started, who were you associated with, if anybody?
Well, when I first started, I started as what is called a sundowner, and I had an old desk in the back of a real estate organization at 2202 Wilson Boulevard, and shared a desk with Everett Demarest, who became a member of the insurance community out here. Later, my first law partner was really Winston Krickenberger.
And after that, who was your next law partner?
After that, I went in the service in 1943 in the Navy. When I returned, I soon associated with William D. Medley, who was the lawyer for the Virginia lawyer for the D.C. law firm of Douglas O'Bear and Camel. And later we became partners and bought the firm, the district firm's interest out in the law practice in Virginia, and the firm became known as Medley and Garnett.
Okay. Paul, same questions to you. When and where did you graduate from college?
I graduated from George Washington University, both the undergraduate school and the law school. And I passed the bar February 1950.
And when did you come to Arlington County?
Sometime before that.
What drew you to come to Arlington?
Well, what happened was I was discharged from the World War, as a veteran, World War II, and I was looking for a place to live, and I was really looking in District of Columbia, but I found something in Arlington. I got an apartment in Arlington, and I stayed ever since.
And who was your first employer here in Arlington? Or who did you first come to work with?
Well, I went to work with Lou Koudelakis, and we formed a law firm.
Did you have occasion to serve in the office of the Commonwealth Attorney?
Yes, I did, under Denman T. Rucker.
Let me show you. Can you identify who that is?
That was my boss. He hired me as an assistant Commonwealth Attorney. It was my first job.
And that's Denman T. Rucker?
That's right.
Tell everybody, the Commonwealth Attorney, was that an appointed position or was that elected by the public?
That was elected by the public.
And how long did you serve in the Commonwealth Attorney's office?
A year and a half.
And where did you go after that?
Into private practice.
And that's when you formed your partnership with Lou Koudelakis?
That's correct.
And what was the nature of your practice when you and Lou joined?
Well, I did mostly family law. He did mostly criminal law, and I did some criminal law.
Grady, where did you go to college and when?
I went to LSU. That's Louisiana State University.
Yes, sir.
And I graduated in 1941.
And what brought you to this area?
The military. When I graduated in 41, I got three certificates at one time. One of them said you are graduated, the other says you are commissioned as a second lieutenant. The other one says you are assigned to active duty for 1 year in the Army. I ended up with Omar Bradley's headquarters in 1945. And he was appointed Administrator of Veterans Affairs, and I was one of the 14 that came to the Veterans Administration on a military detail. I liked the agency, so I stayed with it for 32 years.
When did you first move to Arlington County?
I moved here in 1945.
And have you continued to reside in the county since then?
I've continued.
Okay. When did you go to law school?
I went to law school and started in 1948, graduated in 1952.
And what law school was that, sir?
GW.
Did you at that time pass the Virginia State Bar?
Yes, I did.
Did you immediately go into private practice in Arlington?
No, I had a choice of either going into private practice or remaining with the Veterans Administration in the General Counsel's office, and I elected to stay with the Veterans Administration.
Did you join the Arlington County Bar Association?
Yes, I did, and I participated in a number of the activities of the county in more of the meetings and associations meetings.
All right. Let me ask you, Grady, I'll work backwards a little. When you came to Arlington County, describe the county.
The county was a completely different place from what it is today. It was almost residential homes. You had nothing like the high rise you have now in several different areas. The roads were not nearly as big or as wide or as heavily traveled as they are today.
How about the area around the courthouse?
I was around the courthouse a good bit. I found that the old courthouse was a kind of a central place in this whole area.
And where were the attorney's offices when you came out here?
My first office was with Bankhead Davies in what's called the Dixie Building. And the building for most of the offices at that time were in the street where the courthouse and the jailhouse is now. It seemed that it was congregated primarily with lawyers around this area.
Did that have the nickname Lawyers Row?
Yes, it did.
Okay. Dad, you came here a little before either one of these gentlemen. What do you recall Arlington County being like when you got here?
Country.
Describe it.
The courthouse area, there was only one building on the courthouse green as such, and that was the old central part of the courthouse. Back about 50 paces was a little red brick building, which was the jail. At the time I came out, there were no high-rise buildings. The only buildings that existed where the buildings are on Courthouse Row in the front, the biggest of which was the three-story building of Jesse Phillips, Kling, and Kendrick. And then around the corner on 14th Street were a series of little low one-story buildings, and they were occupied. One of them was Lincoln Mackey, who was a surveyor whose father was a well-known lawyer in Arlington. And then there was the Douglas Building on the corner, in which I had my law firm with Winston Krickenberger, and it was owned by the firm of Douglas, O'Bear, and Camel, a Washington law firm. Mm. There weren't more than 25 trial lawyers in all of Arlington when I first moved out here.
Now, the courthouse that you described it in 1940, what courts and what other offices, if any, were in there?
The whole county machinery, practically speaking, was in there. The police department had the first floor turret. The county court had the first and only trial room on the first floor, and the circuit court had the big trial room on the second floor. The county clerks, where the cases were filed, the real estate books were kept, was to the left of the entrance. And it was the building at that time before anything was constructed, either wing that later came on.
Where was the jail?
The jail was in the little brick building behind the courthouse to the right.
Do you recall the size of either the police department or the sheriff's department?
Yeah. The police department was a single room with a radio in it on the first floor, and the picture of the courthouse you've got there, it was in the turret only. It had the first floor turret was the police department.
Let me show you. Now, this picture was taken approximately 1953. This isn't quite the building you've described,
is it? No, the building I described is just this portion in here.
Okay, so
that was it.
The wings were not added.
The wings had not been added.
Okay.
And the jail was in the brick building, and the sheriff's office was in the brick building that was behind the courthouse.
Paul, when you came out here, is this the way the courthouse looked?
That's correct.
Grady?
Oh, even when I came here, it was just one building. It did not have the wings that seem to be there now.
Okay.
And Judge McCarthy had his office on the second floor in the turret room that the police department occupied on the first floor.
Was there an elevator in the building?
No, it was a wide steel staircase that went from the front entrance right straight up to the second floor.
I assume there was no air conditioning in the building?
I assume you were right. No, there wasn't any at that time.
You were telling me about Judge McCarthy would sit with his, describe that.
McCarthy's room was very hot, and it had two little narrow windows, and he had a habit of going up on the third floor every now and crawling out and sitting and studying his cases outside on the ledge of the courthouse because it was so hot in his courtroom or in his office.
Paul, when you came out here, who do you remember to be the judges?
Only Judge McCarthy in Arlington and in Fairfax. And later on, joining with Judge McCarthy was Judge Medley. And they were the two of them together, and then came Judge Hosmer after that.
You've described Judge McCarthy. He was the circuit court judge.
Circuit court judge.
How about a lower court judge, whatever the name of the court was and who the judges might have been?
At that time, Hugh Reed sat both in the juvenile and domestic relations court and also the general district court.
Was Judge Hendricks here when you came?
If he was, he was just leaving at that time.
He was here when I was here. Before him, I'm sure Judge Harry Thomas used to sit in the county court.
Well, since you've mentioned, both of you mentioned some of these names,
yes.
Paul, can you identify?
I'd like to very much. This is quite a picture here, having all the judges. From my left is Judge Harry Thomas. And then it's his son, Homer Thomas.
Was he a judge?
And he was a judge, too. And Homer Thomas had a son, Harry Lee Thomas, who passed away here about a month ago.
And he was a substitute judge.
And he was a substitute judge. And then I think that was Tom Clark, Justice of the Supreme Court. And then Judge Medley, Circuit Court of Arlington County, and Paul Brown, Paul D. Brown, I believe it was, of Arlington, because there's a Paul
Brown in Fairfax.
In Fairfax. Right. Both Circuit Court judges. And then Judge Hosmer, Judge McCarthy, and Judge Hugh Reed.
Am I correct that Judge Reed may have been the first juvenile court judge in the Commonwealth of Virginia?
I think so, exclusively. Domestic relations.
That's right, exclusively. But before that, the county court judges had both jurisdictions, both county jurisdiction and juvenile jurisdiction.
You're correct, yeah.
Okay. Grady, when did you start practicing in Arlington County?
Let me back up a little to say that when I graduated from law school in 1952, I had a choice of either going into private practice or staying with the Veterans Administration. I elected to stay with the Veterans Administration, and I stayed there for 32 years. And I did not start my practice as a lawyer in Arlington until 1969. So I'm a newcomer compared to these fellows.
Well, when you started in 69, who did you start with? Who did you associate
with? I started with Bankhead Davies in the Dixie building.
What kind of practice did you do? What kind of law did you do?
I was doing probate work almost exclusively, wills, estates, and probate.
Now, even though you weren't practicing in Arlington, my understanding, you were very active in the Arlington community as far as doing community service, that kind of thing?
Yes, even though my legal work was in Washington, I got quite involved in county activities.
Describe those for us.
Well, the Committee of 100, I think, is maybe one I could mention. That's a meeting where people meet on a weekly or monthly basis and discuss public issues. I become active with the Chamber of Commerce. I got active with the Lions Club. I joined the, I made a list of the things I had. The United Way, I was on their board for 7 years. I got, I was the second chairman of the county fair, second, and I chaired that for 4 years. And I stayed quite active with several activities that my wife was interested in. We formed a group that had what we call ice cream social in our yard, raising money to give to the Arlington Hospital. They furnished the ice cream, the women furnished the cakes, and we had the ice cream social, and we did this for 29 years.
Where was your house located?
At 224 North Jackson Street in Ashton Heights area.
Not far from Columbia Garden Cemetery?
That's right, yes.
When you first came out here, was there an Arlington Hospital?
The Arlington Hospital was one small building, which had a wooden wing off to the right of it, if you faced it. And my wife started work there, and that was her first assignment. She was a nurse. Her first assignment was at that wing, and it was all black patients at that time.
When would this have been?
This would have been in about 1946.
Dad, when you came here in 1940, was there an Arlington hospital?
The hospital was formed really by the action of several men here in Arlington. Among them was B.M. Smith. What's the boy? He was a lawyer here for a long time. There were three men that I remember. One was the head of the lumber company down in
Roswell.
Huh? Roslyn, and the other was a head was B.M. Smith, and the other was his lawyer. His son's name was Ed.
Holland.
Not Holland. Well, anyway, there were three of them, and when they formed it, I can remember that John Anderson. I was on one of the earlier boards of Arlington Hospital for years. I can remember John Anderson going to B.M. Smith and to Lawrence Douglas and several others, borrowing enough money to meet the payroll for the weekend, and then he'd pay him back when the receipts would come in from the patients in the next week.
Okay. Both you gentlemen had some involvement with an idea that Arlington County might become a city?
Yes.
Would you tell us about that?
Well, I can't remember the exact dates, but the Arlington County Board was being asked by a number of citizens why we shouldn't be a city. So the county board appointed a commission, and it was Ed Camel, myself, and one other. And we spent a year in research to determine whether the county should stay a county or become a city. And we reached the final determination and recommendation to the county board. Primarily, I think it was on account of the payment for the road systems in the county that we should stay as a county.
Grady, you had some involvement in that?
I was on the fringe of that in many respects. And you're right. The final decision, I think, rested on the fact that if we became a city, the county or the state would discontinue paying the road expenses in the city. And that was a turning factor.
Paul, when you came out here, how many lady lawyers were there?
The one that I remember was Anna Hedrick.
Was she here when you got here?
If not exactly that time, short time thereafter.
And what kind of practice did she do?
General practice.
Do you remember Lucille Lambert?
Oh, yes, I remember Lucille Lambert.
How long after did she come?
Oh, I imagine about 10, 15 years later, and she also served in the Commonwealth Attorney's Office.
Okay. At the time you came out here, do you recall there being any black attorneys?
No.
Yes.
Monroe?
Well, Raby, who spent more time in Arlington than he did in Alexandria. George Raby.
Not at that time.
Yeah,
he
was
came in later. You might be right.
Well, did Tom Monroe come out here?
Yes, he did.
And did you get to know Tom Monroe?
Yes, I did. I'd like to say Tom Monroe, when we had our yearly function, and we had a golf tournament, and he couldn't play at Washington Golf and Country Club because he was black. And so he was a very fine golfer. And I saw him come off the course there at, not Washington Golf,
Army
but
Navy.
Army Navy. And I asked him what he shot, and he shot in the, low 80s or high 70s. And I said, "You mean you made us all come over here on a lousy score like yours?" And he laughed, and he took it so well. He was just a fine gentleman.
And Tom Monroe became a general district court judge and then became
a circuit court
judge. But also talking about segregation, I think we'd have to talk about Ed Campbell. And you knew Ed Campbell.
Ed Campbell was a very competent lawyer, particularly in the school board cases and also in constitutional law cases. He was a very capable lawyer.
All right. The Arlington County Bar Association, when you came here in 1940, how big was it? How many members?
I guess it would be 30 at a bar meeting. Bar Association meeting.
And where were the lawyers' offices at that time?
Right just around the courthouse. Jimmy Simmons had a corner office, which he built, and then the rest of them were right in front of the courthouse or in the little buildings on 14th Street. There wasn't a single high rise here. at that time.
I am told that the lawyers during breaks in court would play horseshoes. Do you recall that?
Yes, I do. There was a horseshoe ring on the south side of the courthouse. And so far as I can remember, practically every member of the court used to come out at lunchtime, or if they weren't busy, and they would pitch horseshoes out there.
Grady, were you one of the pitchers?
I was. I had played horseshoes from early days, and I remember very well that we played horseshoes on the courthouse grounds.
I can tell you in the early days an interesting facet. They didn't have the jury system like they did now. But at the courthouse at that time, there were several benches under big trees. And there were a number of people who used to occupy those benches when they knew that the juries were being set for trial cases. And they would go out there and sit. And sure enough, out would come one of the bailiffs or deputy sheriffs and said, they want you in there to be a jury. And that's the way frequently the juries were formed.
Let me stay with the Bar Association for a minute. There were a number of activities that the bar did, Paul. Do you remember the smokers or the skits?
Oh, that was one of the highlights. And of course, your dad was one of the main ones that put it together, along with
Bill Chadwick.
Bill Chadwick.
Tom with Adams Porter, Tom Hayes.
And then
Hayes,
you had a professional piano player that used to come in.
There wouldn't have been a bar skit except Olin Adams, who was a friend of mine, was a brilliant jazz musician from New York who lived the life of a musician up there, but it wrecked his wife's health, so he moved south. And he was the one who made the bar skits really spin because he knew what he was doing in arranging the music.
Would there be rehearsals for these skits?
Oh, sometimes for weeks. And we had a dance team put together one year, about 12. I wish I had a picture of it. Members of the bar who rehearsed 6 weeks before the bar skit for a line dance that they did all dressed in female garb.
I'm glad you can't find it.
Is one of the dressers, one of the line dancers sitting to my right?
One of the line dancers is sitting to your right.
Who else do you recall being in that dance skit?
Oh, that was Lou Koudlakis.
Earl Schaefer?
Harold Schaefer, George Towner, Orrin Lewis Jr., several others.
All right. Where were these smokers held?
At the two country clubs.
Army, Navy, and Washington?
Yes.
And would they be widely attended?
Very, very. In fact, we were thinking about putting it on the road. It was a professional group Griff put together.
The State Bar Association asked us if we would keep the skit together one year and bring it down to the state bar as entertainment. I said no, that they didn't have the time to do that.
The Bar Association still does and gave out for years an annual award called the Man with the Most. Do you recall that, either one of you?
Yes, unfortunately.
Yes, I'm in that.
In that category.
Tell me
you
are
in that category.
Tell me what that was or is. What was the Man of the Most award?
Well, it was the award they used to give was a man with throwing a bull over his shoulder. And I guess you know what that denotes.
Man with the most.
Well, with the most bull in the four-letter word.
And how long back was it given? It was given back many years, wasn't it?
Yes, 40, 50 years ago.
Now, of course, it's given not just to men, but to women also. It probably should be changed. But it was sponsored by an outfit called the Radio Building Bar Association. Does that ring a bell?
Yeah, well, the radio building does. That was right behind the courthouse over by Wilson Boulevard.
Let me talk to a related subject with regard to the Bar Association, and that is legal aid or pro bono services. Grady, you did a lot of pro bono work, didn't
you? I did, when I first started my practice, almost exclusively pro bono. And I got involved because we had a person at our church where was very interested in the San Salvadorans that were immigrating here. And I was being called on to represent them. I represented one after one of them. And almost my, I'd say 50 to 60% of the time I spent in practice, I was pro bono.
Was this under the aegis of the church or was it under the aegis of the Bar Association?
Bar Association.
Okay. Dad, when you were here in 1940, how were legal services rendered to those who couldn't pay?
They were assigned. When the cases would come up, the court would ask for volunteers. The circuit court judge would ask for volunteers. If not, you assigned it. He said, this is your obligation. You've got to take this case. But if you weren't competent in that field, you would be excused. But that's the way it was handled at that time before they formed the regular committee to handle it.
Paul, how do you remember the pro bono and legal services to the poor?
We all served. We were all obligated to serve. I served, but for a very short time. But I think everybody had their turn at it.
That's right.
It seemed to me you were appointed by the court without...
Oh, yes.
You were not appointed. You were told by the
well,
court.
That's right. You were told.
Judge McCarthy was getting ready to appoint.
You weren't asked if you would like to. You were told you would do it.
Oh, that's right.
I remember one time Judge McCarthy was ready to appoint someone, and I started getting out of the courtroom in the back door because I didn't want the case. And Judge McCarthy stopped me in my tracks. He said, are you going somewhere, Mr. Bruce? I said, oh, no, Your Honor. And he said, I want to appoint you to a case. I said, I'd be glad to serve. And everybody started laughing. So, but we all did serve our time.
That's right.
Grady, speaking of community service, when we talked yesterday, we talked about what you might say to a new lawyer today and how you blend in your legal practice with community service.
I got very much involved in my community activities almost ahead of my legal practice. And I would, with some reticence, say that you can get more involved in legal than in your social life and your community activities to where it actually almost eats up time where you should be in the legal practice. Now, this may sound contradictory to what most people advocate, but you do need, in the beginning of practice, to set up a schedule of time that you're going to give to community life and a schedule of time you're going to give to your legal practice because you've got to get into the legal practice. So I'm saying that you, as a beginning lawyer, you have to sort of watch that you don't become too involved in community life, which is, I think, what I might have done because of coming out of government service. I was asked to be on a number of committees before I set up a legal practice. And I was very, very much involved in my community life before I really got heavily involved in my legal practice.
Well, do we all agree, though, that as practicing lawyers, we do owe some duties to the community of giving back?
Oh, very definitely. You owe it to the community.
Well, one thing I would say about the younger lawyers, I know when I came out, it was a general practice, but the general field of law has changed so in the last 50 years that if you don't equip yourself or be equipped in either in law school or shortly thereafter in a specialty, I think present day it becomes very difficult because there are very few general practitioners as such left.
Paul, would you agree with that?
Yes, I wanted to bring that up and you covered it very well. That's exactly right. These days, you have to have a specialty. And if you don't, there's no such thing as the general practitioner. It's just about a gone.
That's right. I think that became very obvious when we began to develop the metro line. You found that you had to be either a general practitioner and you were going to do small practice, or you got to get involved in commercial type of activity. You had to specialize.
Grady, you were talking about how back when you started, it was a lot easier gaining access to the courthouse, access to the files, things like that. Tell us about that.
Well, it was a wide open building, day and night. You could walk into the building and go into the stacks at any time you want and pull a file you were interested in. Nobody questioned you. No one was there to assist you in most instances. So it's quite a contradiction that we have today to what it was then.
You know, I want to, I just noticed something. It's quite interesting. There's so many father sons in this in the Bar Association here. Right here now, you're a son, father, George and I, Denman Rucka, there's three generations there. The Thomases, three generations, Harry Homer and Harry Lee.
And there's Tom Jackson and his son.
And Bankhead Davies, just so many of them, they go on and on. And I thought that was pretty interesting.
While we're talking about Bar Association and lawyers, how about the name Doc Blackman?
Oh.
Doc Blackman had a drugstore right close by the courthouse. And although it was a drugstore, he had booths in there and tables, and you could have lunch. And it seemed that most all the lawyers used to go there and have lunch together. And what they would do also, which I thought was very interesting, if you were a young lawyer just starting practice, you'd go there and have lunch. And they would introduce you to the older lawyers, and we would give cases to...
That was a gathering spot.
That's right. And we'd give cases to them and get them started. So it was no such thing as a young lawyer not having a case to work on, because we always should take care of them. But you had to go down to Doc's. And what was his name, Doc?
Blackman.
Blackman, that's correct. Yeah, that was a spot that all the lawyers used to frequent.
There wasn't anything on that side of the street, except next to him was the DeLashmet Survey Office.
That's right, exactly.
Was another restaurant Chet's Raw Bar?
Well, that came a little later.
Right. Is that right?
Yeah.
Yeah, that was another gathering place.
You and Lou Koutalakis, when you formed your partnership, you eventually wound up working in the Southern Building.
Yes.
Is that
we
right?
We put up the Southern Building, Arne Lewis and Lou and I.
Who was Arne Lewis?
Arne Lewis was our federal judge.
And who wound up owning the Southern Building? It was you and Lou and Orrin, wasn't it?
That's right.
Describe Orrin Lewis in less than a half an hour.
There's no way you can describe him. He was a character of the first degree. He was a great guy. George served as his law clerk, and he thinks the world of Judge
Orrin
Lewis.
Lewis and I graduated in the same class at law school.
All right.
And I worked for the Times Herald, second job, while I was with the district court. And Orrin Lewis at that time was the Arlington distributor for the Washington Times Herald. And on Saturday morning, all of us who worked in the advertising area of the Times Herald used to wait for Orrin Lewis to come in, because he and the distributor manager for the paper would have the wildest arguments over how many papers had been sold in Arlington the week before. And they would think they're going to be in a fist fight, and the next thing you know, they'd agreed going out to have lunch together. It was some wild talk that they would have.
When do you recall Orrin coming over to Arlington?
Shortly after I came over, he came over.
Now, would it be fair to say that Arlington was one of the few Republican attorneys in Arlington County in 1940?
You mean that Orrin Lewis was?
Orrin Lewis.
Yes, I can name the Republicans who were outstanding at that time. There were three. One of them was the treasurer, John Locke Green. Another one was the commissioner of revenue, who lived over, I'm trying to think of his name there. And the other one was a guy who wasn't a lawyer, but who was around a lot. It was our neighbor who played
Lee Potter.
Lee Potter. And those three were the bulwark of the Republican Party in Arlington County.
What was the majority makeup of the county was Democratic, wasn't it?
Well, it was Harry Flood Byrd, Democratic. Until later on, when the big apartments were built, they became much less conservative. But Arlington was a conservative Democrat stronghold, and Harry Green, who was the clerk, was the majordomo of the political life, he and Charlie Fenwick, under the aegis of Harry Flood Byrd. They were the committee in Arlington.
And were you involved in the
yes,
Arlington
to some
politics?
Extent.
How about you, Paul?
No, I wasn't.
I
really.
Was.
I ask this of all of you. What Arlington court official stood out in your mind?
Well, I can, for one, I can say Walter McCarthy. Oh.
Grady?
Judge McCarthy. And Walt. The clerk, Betty. Don't call the last name.
Waldo?
Waldo. Betty Waldo. Those two are stand out in my mind.
I want to say Judge McCarthy by far.
Yeah.
He was just outstanding.
You were telling me at one time there was an effort to put Judge McCarthy on the Virginia Supreme Court.
Yes, and we sent a delegation down to Richmond. And there used to be, I think it was very interesting, a barber. Had a barber shop there, and all the politicians used to go in there. And when he saw several of us, he asked us what we were doing there, and I told him we were there to try to get Judge McCarthy on the Supreme Court. He says, you're wasting your time. He says, so-and-so is going to be appointed. And sure enough, he knew what he was talking about. They had told him, and Judge McCarthy never got the appointment.
What was so special about Walter McCarthy?
Well, he was a judge personified.
Yeah.
He had all the...
good ingredients.
All the good ingredients, right. He was a fine person. He was fair, impartial, and very, very bright.
Yeah.
And I think he was just outstanding.
He was down to earth.
Yes, he was. He was down to earth, but he was exceedingly capable as a jurist.
Let me mention a couple other names. How about Senator Frank Ball?
Senator Frank Ball was, I guess you'd say, the essence of a trial lawyer in Arlington at that time. He was a very capable orator, and he was exceedingly bright, and he didn't dwell long on research, but he would pick it up in the courtroom faster than anybody I've ever seen.
Oh, he was outstanding. I remember one time he was trying a case and showed the personal touch he had, and something was said, and someone had laughed or made a noise in the courtroom, and he turned around and he said to the jury, he says, you see, they don't know what problems we have, and he kept on saying we. He did everything but jump in there with the jurors. And of course, he was, I don't think he had any equal in the county or the state.
No, I don't either.
As far as a trial lawyer is concerned.
Judge Russell, Justice Russell, a month ago when asked why he became a lawyer, told of being a 10-year-old boy watching a trial in which Walter McCarthy was the judge, Frank Ball was a defense counsel, and Lawrence Douglas was a prosecutor.
Oh, my goodness.
And Justice Russell said when he saw that trial, that's when he knew he wanted to be a lawyer.
He was seeing the best that
he
we had.
Best. Yes, that's right.
Do any of you remember Crandall Mackey?
I do.
Who was Crandall Mackey?
Crandall Mackey had been Commonwealth Attorney for Arlington before Lawrence Douglas was appointed. And it was Crandall Mackey and Sheriff Fields, who cleaned out Roslyn, which was a hotbed of gambling and everything illegal that you can think of, and they formed a citizen's posse. This is way back when, deputized them all, and in one night they cleaned out what had been the eyesore of the county. They got rid of them.
Did Crandall Mackey physically go down there?
Oh, yes.
That's a different.
Colonel Mackey and the sheriff and the so-called formalized deputies that had been deputized for that occasion. It's way back when, but they cleaned it out.
Let me run a couple other names by you. Tom Phillips.
Oh, Tom was a character in his own right in every respect. He was a capable lawyer, particularly in the field of zoning and land problems. But he was not only articulate, but well-read. And on the bar skits, he made contribution after contribution in parodies of songs and things of that type. He had a wonderful sense of humor. And I think Paul had one of his handwritten diaries, if I'm not mistaken.
That's right.
Yeah. What was that about, Paul?
He put a book together and had a lot of the people that we spoke about. And I'm trying to think of the name of the book. Do you remember?
I don't remember, but I remember reading it because I read it. You loaned it to me to read.
Yeah. Did you ever give it back to me?
Let me mention another name, Jimmy Simmons.
Well, Jimmy Simmons, I guess Griff was closer to him than I was.
I met Jimmy Simmons early on when I came out here, and it was in 1950, I think it was. Jimmy was president of the bar and a very capable president, and the other bar associations in Alexandria and Fairfax had a skit night or a roast night, and Jimmy came to me and knew that I'd done some work in the theater and asked me if I would help to put together a bar skit. And that's how the bar skit in Arlington arose, was Jimmy asking me to put something together.
I tell you, a lawyer who I always respected, and you all knew him better than I, was Lee Bean. Remember Lee Bean?
Lee Bean was a tragic story. Lee Bean was an excellent student and was an excellent athlete. And he was on the football team at Hampton, Sydney when he got infantile paralysis. And he was crippled from that time on, but he never let it interfere with what he was doing or his trial practice. Right. He was a very capable and an easygoing guy to get along with. You'd think that he would be a little bit different, but he was very good.
I remember Lee would, when he was counsel and at counsel table, he'd be sitting and the judge would come in and everybody's supposed to rise and the judge would tell Lee, Mr. Bean, you don't have to rise. No siree. Lee
he
Bean.
He would suffer through it.
Absolutely. Out. He was wonderful in that regard. How about J. Foster Hagen?
Not another one ever like him.
How's that?
He had a wonderful sense of humor. He'd been the school teacher at Washington Lee High School before he became a lawyer, and he was an English teacher, among other things. And for years after he became a member of the bar, he wrote the bar weekly or monthly paper. Yeah. And I forget what the name of it is.
About the Hornet?
The Hornet. He used to write the Hornet.
That's correct.
That's right. And he was the editor, and some of his editorials were right on point, but they irritated a lot of people.
Paul, when you came out here, did you come out here before Lou Koutoulakis?
Yes, a year before.
Were you the first Greek lawyer in Arlington?
I think so, that's right.
I'm sure so.
How were you received by the lawyers in the bar, at least initially?
Initially, it was a little tough. There was some prejudices, but they finally wore away.
Good.
I'll say that's true.
Today's lawyers, well, let's strike it. Let's do it this way. Over the years that all of you have practiced, how has the practice of law changed in Arlington County?
Well, I can say this. When I first started practicing, I got to know all the lawyers almost on a personal basis. A handshake, and that was it.
That's right.
It was fine. You didn't have to worry about a thing. So they told you something. But nowadays...
You want it in writing.
I want it in writing.
Yeah, it was very informal, and it was almost like a fraternal group. If somebody gave you their word, You never have to go beyond that.
That's right.
You agree with that, Grady?
Wholeheartedly.
How about, you expected any backup paper or any confirmation. You accepted what they said was going to be done.
Do you think the practice of law is harder now than it was back when you all started?
Oh, much harder. Oh, I'm so glad
I think there's a drastic change.
A rat race, you might say.
What do you think that's attributed to?
The influx of a lot of lawyers.
Population.
That's exactly right.
The largest.
A lot of the overflow from the district coming over to Virginia.
Yeah.
I think you're confronted now with much larger law offices where you specialize. You don't get really to know the other people that are in the law firm or even in the other practice except whatever particular field you're specializing in. I don't think that there is a intimacy among lawyers as a whole in the county.
Do you think there's anything that we as lawyers can do about that, or is that inevitable?
I think it's like the growth of the county. It's a part of what has happened.
That's right.
It's specialized. The demands on the lawyers, I think, are more. More restricted, perhaps more greater. You're working for larger corporations instead of human beings. You're working for corporations now, not human beings, and they expect perfection. They expect it without any detail.
What activities would you like to see the Bar Association do that maybe it's not doing now?
Could I answer that?
Sure. This is a generic question.
I think that we perhaps owe more to the community than what we're giving in the way of community service, and I think that I say that because I was very involved in community service, and I think I wouldn't recommend it being as extensive as I was, but I think we do owe it to the community, and I don't think we have to look to legal aid to have it provided.
Do you think that we owe it more than other groups, doctors, others? You are an exception to the rule.
I don't think.
I don't know what I owe to the community. I've served my time in the bono work, but you give me a feeling that we owe it, and I don't know what we owe.
I think we owe it to them as human beings, not as. Not as a community group. I think that you have individuals that come to you that wants advice or assistance, and they can't afford it.
Oh, I think we all served our time on that.
It's that kind. I don't think you. I don't think you have to run a legal aid service of your own. I think that you have to. You have to give to people to come to you and say, "Can you help me?" And if they cannot afford it, I think we ought to do it.
Right. I agree with that.
Well, I think, among other things, the bar has gotten so big that it's lost some of its cohesiveness that we used to have in understanding and agreement. And I think one of the things that can be done is to probably have more frequent meetings with a given general purpose, because all of us tend to become specialized, but if we know each other better, I think then the some of the barriers that we now have created for ourselves can be relaxed to a certain extent if there's trust among the lawyers with whom you're dealing, and that generally isn't the case at the present time.
You know, it's ironic that nowadays certain associations have a code of collegiality and how to get along with your fellow lawyers. From hearing you all talk back when you started, that wasn't necessary to put it in writing. That was an unwritten rule.
That's right.
Go ahead.
You were a smaller number, closely associated with each other in what you were doing. You weren't specialized. You were more generalized, and you felt a more cohesiveness with the persons you were associating with.
Well, let me ask you this as kind of a wrap-up line of questioning. Looking back now, back through your careers and when you first started, how do you feel about being an Arlington or having been an Arlington attorney? And I ask this of each of you.
Well, I for one, think it gave us a good opportunity. And the Bar Association and the practice of law has been very good to me, and I'm very thankful. I don't think that a community could do much more for anyone starting the practice of law than Arlington County.
Well, I agree. The county as such has afforded me an excellent livelihood as a lawyer, but not only that, it has afforded my family a very lovely way of life, so far as I'm concerned.
That's right.
And I owe it a great deal in that respect that I can never repay, but I do that by trying to make friends still with those that I become associated with. It's been a wonderful place to work. Really, we had all the advantages of growth and everything else. I couldn't have asked for more.
Grady?
I think as both a government attorney and a private attorney that it's a great profession. And I think that it's rewarded me in many ways. I had some relationship with people I would never have thought I would be able to speak to or touch to. People like the Chief Justice of the United States. I was admitted to the Supreme Court by a person that I would never have thought I'd know. It was my contact and my profession that enabled me to meet people that I thought I would highly respect. I thought enough of the profession that I tried to get my oldest son to follow me. And he says, look, I'm not cut out to be a lawyer. I'm going to be an accountant.
Oh, I've been lucky.
And I think he was smart because he was not temperamentally prepared to be a lawyer. But I think it's a great profession.
Well, I think the county has done fair by, or wonderfully, by all of us in here.
Well, gentlemen, I think I speak on behalf of the foundation and for the Bar Association that this has been fascinating. This has been wonderful to hear your insights and your memories. I thank you all. And with that,
well, I feel privileged to have lived this long to be able to do it.
Well, I feel like a newcomer when I talk to some of you people about names that I have heard but never thought I'd ever see. Well, I knew I'd never see them.
Paul, I want to thank you again for doing this. This has been wonderful, Dad. It's been just tremendous.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I thank you for the work that you've done.
Well, it's been a wonderful experience for me to learn what these distinguished people know. I think it's going to benefit, hopefully it'll benefit not only the Bar Association, but Arlington County, to see what tremendous accomplishments and contributions to the county these gentlemen, as well as those who've gone with them, before them and after. And we will continue with further tapings on this to record and preserve the history of the Arlington County Bar. Thank you all again.